right? If you're able to track and there's a leak that seems, there's a spike in usage and it seems not normal, then we're able to look at it and say, perhaps there's something deeper to look at. And we try and look at around their home to see what might be leaking. And then we make some adjustments accordingly.
And how are people made aware of that, being able to track that? I'm just wondering, and going back to Vito Masticello's point about the outreach that they're doing to 500 properties, I'm just wondering if there's a pairing between what DEP is doing and what HPD is doing to look at that.
We work closely with HPD. Every time they do a homeowner forum, we go out and we are at front and center speaking to the homeowners, but also every single bill that a homeowner receives, it gives them access to check their MyDEP account, which then they can go on and check real time all of their usage. So that's usually how my office receives complaints about a spike or something that seems off. And then it's sent quickly to our customer services bureau, which tracks that and helps work with the homeowner directly. So they do a lot of hand-holding with the homeowner to make sure they understand their bill and also why there's a spike and then what the next step is.
Is there any thought of, I think that's certainly very, very helpful, but specifically to this rezoning plan and specific to this community with 55% of the housing stock being, you know, 1 to 4, 1 to 5 family, and that really being at the greatest risk of being lost, and considering the water and sewer charges in general being not an insignificant portion of what a property owner might have. I'm just wondering if there's the opportunity to do more, to do door-to-door outreach, and maybe tie that with anything that HPD or other agencies are planning to do. It just seems like for those that are literate about going online and checking those things, or you know, pay a lot of attention to their bills, it's one thing, but I just wonder if the outreach might not be in a particular.
We definitely have templates where we've done door-to-door outreach. We're doing massive grease outreach in Queens where we're reaching 50,000 families related, because 72% of our sewer backups are related to grease. So everyone, don't throw grease down your sink. And so that's something that there's a template for something that we can do. So it's something that we could explore and think about.
Thank you. Any other questions?
And we'll get back to you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Evelyn Cruz, speaking on behalf of Congresswoman Nydia Velasquez. Yes. Welcome, Ms. Cruz.
Good morning. I was number 73. I'm just astounded by the turnout. Well, as you know, Congresswoman Velasquez is in Washington today, and that's why I'm here representing. The Congresswoman, I have a written statement. I may go off script, but let me just start with thanking all of you for this opportunity and the chairman to speak today. As a member of Congress who represents a large majority of New York's waterfront community that spans from the Lower East Side to South Brooklyn to North and Queens, over the years, I have become very familiar with the term rezoning and the process. Rezoning communities such as East New York and Cypress Hills is a historic opportunity for the planners, for the community, and for the city, if it is done right. Based on the gentrification and displacement patterns that I have witnessed in Williamsburg, in great part due to a rezoning that did not adopt mandatory inclusionary affordable housing as she advocated, it is promising to know that today we are discussing that, and it is part of this process, so we commend you for that. The proposed rezoning contains honorable attempts to preserve the community. However, I believe it has room for improvement. Over the past years, the Congresswoman has attending a series of these workshops. I think Winston is exhausted of seeing Nydia at these events and many others. And we've learned from meeting.
You'll never get tired of it.
And Corianne is here too. And so the Congresswoman is saying, listen, we know that change is inevitable. However, it's how we get it done. And how do we not shut the door to the most vulnerable, to the long-term small businesses in the community, and how do we address the needs that are in great demand in East New York and Cypress Hills? The indirect and direct displacement of tenants, especially in unregulated housing. The future displacement of small businesses due to that will be exorbitant rent increases, negative impact on the businesses and manufacturers within the M1 zone. We need a real commitment, 100% permanent affordable housing, and housing that is also at the community's income levels, the diverse income tiers of the community. They've asked for an action, and this is important, a good plan, a good anti-displacement strategy plan. We have one in Williamsburg. It did work. It worked to an extent. We need one that is stronger, that has real enforcement teeth, that can protect long-term residents in this community. It is, you know, the Congresswoman is a member of the Housing and Insurance Subcommittee on the Financial Service Committee. And there it is her goal, her top priority is creating and funding programs to build affordable housing. However, she knows that it cannot be done at the expense of the underserved or the overly benefit developers. Affordable housing here in East New York is critical. And it's just amazing that the crisis is not about poor people only. It is impacted, as we all know, middle-income communities. Here in East New York, a transit worker and a teacher with two children cannot afford housing in East New York and Cypress Hills. The rents are just going out the roof. An example, Arlington Village. I heard Mr. Edgar Gonzalez talk to that earlier. We have been trying with other legislators, with the former congressman, to address Arlington Village for years. Former owner, Reade Street, for years was on the best hit list, the tax, the water and tax lien sale, almost every year with the Department of Finance, owing hundreds of thousands of dollars and allowing these tenants to live in disrepair. And nothing was ever done. And guess what? Now the family was able to successfully sell the property for $20 million or $30 million. And then I'm hearing rumors that the new buyers are interested in flipping it at $60 million. So what do you think that kind of transaction, those transactions are having on the community? This kind of action is now creating a ripple effect to those tenants. As you heard, they want them to move them to the poor end of the development while they can promote the front load of the development, and it's impacting property taxes, or it will impact property taxes on local homeowners. So that is a concern that the member has. As the ranking member of the House Committee on Small Business, she recognizes that entrepreneurship is successful. And in East New York, it has been happening even behind the scenes. You know, the city, you know, many years prior to this administration has really forgotten a lot of East New York. And we have here long-term small businesses that have been here 20, 30 years, fabricators, manufacturers, you know, the culinary industry, they're here. And they need to stay in their community. They have been surviving and creating jobs in this neighborhood when no one cared about East New York. And it is critical that these workers are able to stay here and these employers and these job creators remain. We recently had, out of several that we host, small businesses workshop. On a Wednesday evening, in pouring rain, more than 75 business owners from this community came out to learn about access to capital and how the city of New York, how the SBA, how the SBS can assist them. We did this in collaboration with the Cypress Hills LDC. Then they asked for a follow-up meeting, and then they asked for a third follow-up meeting. So the point is that there are opportunities here for job creation. We have a community that's 19% underemployed. We have a growing, aging community. Cypress Hills just opened up the first or the last senior housing development in Brooklyn. As you know that, right? They're going to create affordable housing. It can be done. We need affordable housing that's going to meet the needs of the population. And unfortunately, some of them are below $12,000. We need to find a way to address that. So we know that I heard earlier this morning there are issues pertaining to Washington, D.C. I don't need to preach you on that, right? But there is a great need. The federal commitment to housing rental assistance, we know, is declining gradually in Washington, D.C. And that is why I'm wrapping up, I promise.
Good, okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
I'm wrapping up. So that is why this plan has to be done thoroughly, with full wide eyes, and in detail, because this is going to be your landmark, or it's going to set a precedent for the city of New York. And with this administration, you know, we look forward to really breaking, or ending the income divide. And it can be done. And the member feels like, listen, we know it's going to happen, but it's got to be done right, as I quoted earlier. So we will submit written statement, and we appreciate the opportunity to address you.
Thank you. That was pretty good off the cuff.
Okay. Any questions? No, not good. Michelle, why are you?
Questions to Ms. Cruz?
Well, first, Evelyn, it's always good to see you. The one thing I would just say, mm-hmm. you know, I think we're all really fortunate that the Congresswoman is down in D.C. because she understands these issues so thoroughly, and we know that she takes the fight to where it needs to be mm-hmm. fought. And I think you heard loud and clear the number of times that the federal government's rollback mm-hmm. on their commitments.
Today they're voting to, again, for the 100th time, repeal Obamacare.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, well, I guess until they get their way. So I just say she should keep up the good fight.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Because the need is there.
Yeah, we know. And you know, as we all know, Chairman, housing, whether it's at Mitchell-Lama, whether it's, you know, owners that are opting out. We've been working with the building commissioner, the housing commissioner who was here a little while ago, for the commissioner for buildings, I should say, you know, in Williamsburg, even in Bushwick. It's outrageous. We need legal assistance. We need a strategy, an anti-displacement strategy. We need funding for it. We need legal assistance. These residents, when you go to housing court, it really tugs at your heart to see children and working families being wrongfully displaced. And this is what we're already starting to see here in Cypress Hills and East New York. And you heard from many of the community residents, and they are on target. So I know I'm going on. We're passionate about this issue. We are committed to working with you, but we need to get it done, per the Congress member. Thank you. Any questions? No? Good?
Thank you very much. Stephen Smith.
Hello. Hello, Commission. My name is Stephen Smith. I work for a real estate investment and brokerage firm, but we have no property or clients in East New York, so I'm speaking on my own behalf. While I'm generally in favor of this rezoning, I'd like to focus my remarks on what is probably New York City's least loved building type, which is newly constructed 1-4 family homes. They're recognizable by their through-wall Fetters or Friedrich brand air conditioning units, the tacky quions, the pitched roofs, and they certainly would not win any design competitions. During the Bloomberg years, these were the target of downzonings across the city by this commission and the Department of City Planning, seemingly as a quid pro quo for an exchange for upzonings resulting in higher density buildings on the waterfront and, you know, major arterials. The de Blasio administration seems to be taking the same tack, proposing to rezone the area around Glenmore Avenue, it's the light area in that map, and another mid-block area in the north, from R5 to R5B, which is in effect a downzoning from FARs of 1.65 with the infill regulations for R5 down to 1.35 under R5B. Borough President Eric Adams and Assembly Member Rafael Espinal seem to be calling for even further, quote-unquote, targeted downzonings of this type. These buildings don't really have any champions, quote-unquote, affordable housing advocates, and this administration don't really care about them since their rents are not regulated. The big developers' lobbies like Rebney seem unaware of their existence. Meanwhile, existing homeowners tend to dislike the aesthetics and the lack of parking. Despite the widespread hatred or antipathy towards these structures, they're the last of a dying breed, which is market-rate development aimed at middle-income New Yorkers without subsidies, without regulated rents. After running the numbers, I found something surprising about these, which I'll call Fetters buildings after those air conditioning units. They're significantly cheaper on a per square foot basis than similar pre-war buildings. In East New York, the average price for a 1-4 family home built during this century, since 2000, is $162 per foot versus $220 a foot for their pre-war counterparts. These are the buildings that everyone seems to be trying to preserve. And there was over 4,000, there was buildings with over 4,000 apartments created since 2000, so this is not an academic discussion. These are actual buildings that are actually being built or were before the crash and probably will again. Similar buildings from the 1990s are cheaper still, suggesting that these properties only get cheaper as they age. It's known as filtering, sometimes derisively known as trickle-down housing. Unlike the middle-income buildings that will eventually rise in East New York if this rezoning passes, these types of homes can be constructed without expensive steel frame construction, elevators, or underground garages, generally for prices that are closer to what you'd find in suburban Texas than New York City. And when you look at the names of these buyers, you find a cross-section of East New York, you find Spanish names, you find Anglophone names, probably African-American, Caribbean descent. You find a growing number of South Asian names. There's a large Bangladeshi community here, and they seem to be snapping these houses up. The buyers are mostly not investors hiding behind LLCs, but ordinary middle-class New Yorkers. So anyway, I recognize these are not the prettiest buildings, and this administration is, for the most part, interested in market rate housing only to the extent that it can be squeezed to pay for market rate development. But ask you to please consider giving these blocks a reprieve. R6B would offer ample room for this type of small-scale growth without requiring expensive parking for buildings under 10 units. And spare what are the last vestige of the real estate of a real estate industry that once built middle-class housing without subsidies. And it might be too late for this rezoning, but it's something to keep in mind in the future. While they aren't necessarily anybody's idea of beautiful, nothing is as ugly as the city's housing market. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. Questions for Mr. Smith? That was pretty efficient. Okay.
Could you send that in writing? That was a great city.
I don't
You don't have to do it today, but just go on our website.
You can send it to us.
I'll figure it out. Okay.
Send it from your phone.
Okay. Straight from your phone.
That's it?
Right. What?
That's it?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. That's helpful. Okay, the next five speakers, and we're numbered just so people can keep track, we're at number 76 through 80, is Renee Arling. Robert Santiago, Mike Smith, James Osikofi, and Alexis Mania.
Good afternoon, City Planning Commissioners. My name is Rene Arling. I'm a resident of Cypress Hills, East New York, Director of Housing Counseling of the Cypress Hills Local Development Corporation, and a member of the coalition. I'm here to testify today on the importance of anti-displacement strategies for tenants and owners in small homes. We're urging you, commissioners, or the Department of City Planning, to vote no on the city's East New York plan. Unless there are strong anti-displacement policies, programs, and resources in place as outlined in the community's alternative plan. I want to mention I have a prepared testimonies, but during the wait, I got into some revisions and revising of some of the testimony. So I'm just going to highlight a couple of key points. So as been said earlier, the housing stock of the Cypress East New York is primarily small homes, and that the East New York rezone area accounting for more than 3,300, that is, the housing stock accounts for more than 3,300 residential units. At three residents per unit, nearly 10,000 people live in this vulnerable housing type. The rezone puts low-income renters at greater risk of losing their apartments to skyrocketing rents, owners at risk of losing their homes because of rising real estate taxes and increased pressures from scammers and speculators. The average median income of homeowners, as we've heard, around $34,000 in Cypress Hills, East New York, is significantly lower than the citywide average, making local owners more vulnerable to housing market changes. Home values in the area have risen by more than 150% since 2012, prompting increases in taxes and rents. We're proposing ways to prevent displacement in these homes. I want to mention that although property values have increased in Cypress Hills, East New York, there's still tremendous percentage of properties that are still underwater, that there's still many homeowners who are distressed homeowners who are dealing with foreclosure lawsuits. At least 20 owners are sued every week. This has been going on for at least a year and a half. It rounds up to about 1,000, a little bit less, a little bit more than 1,000 owners being sued in the Supreme Court. So those owners as well as renters who live there are under considerable pressure. Folks have mentioned earlier that there's lots of unsolicited demands for sales of properties, cash offers, increased incidence of deed theft in Cypress Hills, East New York, as a result of this, you know, booming, kind of crazy, wacky market. And I wanted to, before I,
President
City's plan has failed to fully, you know, address the key points of the coalition. We urge that the City Planning Commission vote no on the city's plan again, unless it adopts the community's plan.
Thank you, Mr. Arlen. And you said you had written testimony, and please submit.
Yeah, I'm going to give you the stuff that's prepared. The other part, I'm going to have to submit it on.
You have time to submit it. Any questions? Yes. Ms. Ellos.
Hi, thank you for being here. Considering your role as Director of Housing Counseling, I'm just wondering if you could talk a little bit about the cases that you and your staff are working with related to folks facing foreclosure. Is that primarily folks who've lost income, or is it primarily because real estate taxes have gone up, primarily because water and sewer taxes have gone up? I'm just trying to get a sense of it and how much of it may be potentially linked to the decision that we're facing here.
The majority of the homeowners that we've worked with over the past, I'd say, 5 years since the Great Recession have been struggling as a result of either income reduction or loss of income entirely. Underemployment and also in terms of their difficulties in dealing with taxes and water and sewer charges, that has actually added to the financial burden of these homeowners. And I must add that the homeowners, yes, there are lots of low-income homeowners in Cypress Hills, East New York, but there are also lots of moderate-income homeowners. We find that the majority of the folks that we work with are actually from about 37 years old to like 50, early 50s, 55, 54 years old. Those folks, by the way, the past 2 or 3 years, we've been monitoring the tax liens sales that have been happening in Cypress Hills, New York, and each year there have been at least 1,200 homeowners in the zip codes, Community Board 5, that have been struggling with tax lien sales, the threat of tax lien sales, very high water bills, sewer charges, property tax issues, and that, by the way, there's a strong strategy for the commission to consider the mayor's plan to consider to address the issues of the property taxes and sewer and water charges.
Thank you.
Any other questions, Ms. Rowland? Thank you.
Thank you.
Robert Santiago.
Good evening. Oh, not yet. 15 minutes, 10 minutes. Okay. Good afternoon, commissioners. My name is Robert Santiago. I'm the executive director of Highland Park Community Development Corporation. And we are members of the Coalition for Community Advancement. I will testify today on the importance of a retail plan to strengthen the commercial corridors, the rezoning area, and the need to implement anti-displacement policies for small businesses in Cypress Hills and East New York. The Department of Small Business Services should be commended. As the Deputy Commissioner indicated, I commend them for partnering with community-based organizations in an effort to conduct community district needs assessment for those corridors affected by this rezoning plan. Those corridors are Liberty Avenue, Pitkins Avenue, Fulton Street, and of course, Atlantic Avenue. There are approximately 500 small mom and pop retail and service shops on these commercial strips, and that they can definitely benefit greatly from city investment in business attraction. I know some of those questions were asked of the Deputy Commissioner. Retention services, storefronts, building improvements, merchant organizing, and small business technical assistance. The commercial district needs assessment will identify the longer term projects that the city will implement to preserve these commercial corridors. We need commitments, and he's also indicated to his credit, the Deputy Commissioner, that there is a commitment, there is a financial commitment to implement these strategic interventions to preserve small businesses in those corridors. However, notwithstanding the potential displacement of small business is still a major concern of the coalition, and we feel that it has not been adequately addressed by the DEIS. Okay. Impact statement concludes that there's going to be a direct displacement of 88 businesses that employ approximately 584 people. Does not constitute a significant adverse effect. It also states that the rezoning intends to increase the amount of retail space for local businesses, and that directly displaced businesses will be able to find space in new developments. We question these assumptions. We doubt that the newly constructed retail spaces without significant public subsidies can match what small businesses are paying in those corridors. So where will these businesses go? Okay, well.
You want to leave us with that question?
Well, just to say that we urge the commission to not approve the plan unless the plan is the alternative plan as presented by the coalition, which has several strategies outlining what we would like to see occur in those commercial corridors. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Santiago. Questions? Thank you. Next speaker is Mike Smith. Mike Smith? No? Next speaker is James Osikofi. Alexis Mania.
What's wrong with the name Alexis? No, that's not my name.
Welcome.
My name is Brother Paul Muhammad. I'm a member of the Coalition East North Advancement.
Are you speaking for Alexis?
Yes. I'm dealing with the housing and equity aspect of it. The Coalition Community Advancement, like, together about over a year and a half ago, my family bought property 46 years ago in East New York. We came approximately 1 year after that historic 1968 Fair Housing Act that was meant to empower the people to get property or own homes. So I applaud my family for that. They died leaving it to me, and I died, and I'll die leaving it to my children. And I bought other property in East New York. But my concern is that as a coalition of houses of worship, the mosque, the Nation of Islam, working closely with other Christian ministries and so forth, as a matter of fact, I come out of the church over there. We found ourselves here representing 50,000 people that have really lacked a voice in what their own self-determination is happening in their community. The scope that we urge the city to amend its scope, where that under the Fair Housing Act of 1968, they were supposed to see how this rezoning would impact this community. This community has an identity. You might not like the fact of what we've been through, but we survived. We survived the disparity of dope, crack, chemical warfare, and we decided redlining. We've been targeted. It's 3 to 40% less chance you'll get a HAMP affordable mortgage. I'm a victim of that. And I'm right now speaking to Congressman Hakeem Jeffries about that. So this community, we've asked for protection dealing with the Fair Housing Act of 1968, but there's a disparity clause. And one word that we find that's been thrown out nowadays, we're more concerned about profits than people. So when you hear the word, and the reactionary government now is hearing the word, we hear the word affirmative, which is built into the 1968 Fair. Affirmative housing doesn't say affordable, it says affirmative. And we don't like to use that word since they dismantled the Affirmative Act. But affirmative housing, it says. And when we're trying to make sure that I have a daughter that's a guidance counselor at the school I graduated, Thomas Jefferson. I have another son that's a chemical engineer, and I have another son that's studying for a CPA. And if I sell my property, none of their salaries can get them back in. So I fought, my family fought for me to stay there and make it through, and we want to make sure that the scope includes the fact of how this would determine the disparity. This past June 25th, 2015, the Supreme Court ruled on the Fair Housing Act dealing with the disparity one race over another. And I know if this goes through, the homeownership in East New York, HPD came out and said very clearly, 65% of the people in East New York are renters. And he said, I said, well, okay, I do my math. You take away 65 from 100, at least 35% are homeowners. So what that means, and the population, the composition of East New York is 98%, and I don't call people Hispanic, I'm sorry, they just speak Spanish and they're black people. So 98% of the people in East New York are black. So if this goes through the rezoning, we want to know the scope. We want them to do, under the Fair Housing Act, to the analysis of what's going to happen to the home ownership there, because that disturbs the wealth base of black and brown, and that's illegal under the Constitution.
Thank you, sir. Questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, the remaining speakers that are all those in opposition, so I will read them in chunks of five and tell you the numbers, and the numbers will skip because we only have people in opposition. If anyone is here to speak in favor, they should go and sign up outside. But the next five speakers are Aida Castillo, Stephen Perez, Pastor James Osikofi, I believe we called him earlier, and he didn't speak, I think we just called him, and Crystal Walthall. Any of those here? You are?
Aida Castillo.
Aida Castillo. How do you do?
How do you do? Good evening, Mr. Chairman and the City Planning Commissioners. My name is Aida Castillo. I'm a lifelong resident of Cypress Hills. My parents own a home there, and I'm very recently became an employee of the Cypress Hills Local Development Corporation. I'm here to talk about creating and preserving green spaces, specifically community gardens. Though the city has very beautiful botanical gardens, many families in my community don't have the extra money to take the public transportation and to pay the admission fees for their families to enjoy these wonderful spaces. And also visitors there are prohibited from using their senses of touch and of taste to really enjoy these plants up close and personally. So back in 2010, a group of community residents, tired of living near vacant lots that were full of garbage and trash and overgrown weeds and of course rodents, unfortunately, we joined forces with the Cypress Hills LDC to obtain the necessary permits to clean and convert. We started with one lot to community garden. While we had many residents willing and able to roll up their sleeves to clear the lots and make this garden happen, we realized we lacked the financial resources to make it happen because it's very expensive to get soil and compost and lumber to build this lot. However, with the leadership and the guidance of the LDC and wonderful organizations as Green Thumb, Grow NYC, New York Restoration Projects and East New York Farms, we were able to get funding for materials, for labor to build these sites. So fast forward to 2016, and there's five new community gardens providing residents with a green space to grow food to feed their families, thus stretching the very little money that many of these families have. It's a space to meet neighbors, to make new friends, and to even get away from the busyness of the city and to recharge yourself mentally. Our children at the gardens have learned about nutrition, about botany, about carpentry, mural painting, and even about raising chickens and enjoying the eggs that are produced here in East New York. And personally, since community gardening is a family affair, Mommy and Papi gave me free rein of planting in the plot whatever I wanted, as long as we had tomatoes, peppers, eggplants, and basil. Anything after that was fair game. So our challenge for our family was to grow new vegetables that we hadn't heard of and certainly hadn't experienced in this neighborhood, such as kale and tomatillos and collard greens. And you know, the garden has even forced us to cross Atlantic Avenue to the other side to get to the garden. And there we've met so many other new residents that, like us, have been in this neighborhood for 30 plus years. So what are we asking for today? We're asking for, since low-income communities lack the economic capacity to implement and maintain urban gardening projects, that shouldn't be an impediment for our neighborhood to enjoy community gardens. We need more green spaces to continue building community. A lot of the benefits, you can't really measure it. Not every parcel of land needs to be developed into a building. Green is such a beautiful color, more beautiful than gray concrete. We ask you to consider converting some of these vacant lots that might be too small to be developed into a building, into a community garden. And that we request that you preserve the land of the current community gardens and also help us fund the maintenance of them. So to close, we call on the commission to vote no unless the city commits to adopting the East New York Community Plan. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Castillo. Questions, Ms. Castillo? Ms. Levin.
Yes, just for clarification. So the five existing community gardens, are they on lots that are listed for development in the EIS?
We're working with the Parks Department and the Mayor's Office to get clarification on them, but I believe that we are protected.
You believe that the existing five are protected?
I believe that, yes.
Okay.
I believe that there are two sites that I don't think they're in dispute that they should be developed for housing, but that the five are protected.
Okay, good. And then you're advocating for additional vacant lots.
Vacant lots and funding to maintain them, maybe slated for development to be used
for community gardens.
We've got a lot of wonderful residents willing to devote sweat equity to work in these lots, but we definitely don't have the funding.
Well, so kudos for your hard work.
Thank you.
And too bad about the kale.
We love kale now. It's part of our weekly. We have a feature at the farmer's market. We have a wonderful kale salad with apple and honey mustard dressing.
Tomatoes and eggs.
It's going to be so last year.
Any other questions for Ms. Castillo? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Stephen Perez. Pastor James Osikofi. I think we called him earlier. I don't think he was here. Crystal Wathel. Okay, the next five numbers are numbers 96 through 100. And they are Jean Sassine, Jonathan Furlong, Andrew Ortiz, Maria Julia Eckhart, and Tupper Thomas. Tupper had to go.
I am not John Furlong, but I'm going to read on his behalf. So my name is Kayla Rivera. Thank you so much for having us this evening. I am the community organizer working with the
But before I get to you substituting for Mr. Furlong, Ms. Jean Sassine is not here, I assume. Okay. Now go. Okay.
Thank you. So in each of the neighborhood rezonings that have been announced, the city has talked about the development of new affordable housing being central to each of them. However, there is serious concern that this new housing will not meet the community needs and be largely unaffordable to its long-term residents. ANHD would like to comment on the levels of income within the East New York study area relative to the levels of affordability the city is proposing, as well as the implementation of strong anti-displacement policies to protect existing units. The city's plan says it will provide affordable housing in two ways, through subsidies and through the new proposed mandatory inclusionary housing program. However, neither of these methods, as currently proposed, would meet the need of the local area's existing residents. Within the study area, over half of the residents in CB5 make less than 50% of the AMI, with a median income of roughly $34,146. Of the 50,704 total households in CB5, 53.0% of them pay more than 30% of their income in rent or costs associated with homeownership. Nearly 30% of these households experience severe cost burden, paying more than 50% of their monthly pay into rent. Within Community Board 16, the median household income is just $27,866. I wanted to paint this picture for you in case it wasn't done earlier. The current MIH proposal does not guarantee housing for households making less than $60,000 of the AMI. The subsidy proposed by the city, while welcome, does not fully solve the problem. Under Ella, 60% of the units constructed would be available for families making 60% of the AMI. 15% of that would be for families at 42% a year, and the other 15 would be roughly for families at 35 a year, and 10% would be marketed for people that are making 25,000 a year. If the Ella program is rising the bar, as Mr. Weinstein said earlier, we need to raise that bar a lot higher. Furthermore, there is no way to guarantee that private developers will take city subsidies. Unlike affordable units that would be required under MIH, which will be guaranteed across the board to be affordable, new development in this area, developers can choose case by case whether or not they want to participate in HPD's subsidy program. While units created under MIH will be permanently affordable, those built, as I stated, under HPD subsidy will only be affordable for a particular period of time, 30 to 50 years, which is what we've seen traditionally in New York City. While the vast majority of housing units within the study area are in small, unregulated buildings, there are approximately 3,000 units of rent-regulated housing, which represent a vital commodity for our neighborhood. One last point. A lot of speakers have come up to the board and said that the money that is being given for tenant organizers and tenant attorneys is not sufficient. I've been a tenant organizer. I am a community organizer. I can stand here and tell you it is not sufficient. Giving someone an attorney to take them to housing court is not how we solve this systematic problem. The way it's done is by ensuring that people can remain in their homes and build prosperous, sustainable communities. With that being said, we do not want the city of New York to push through with the East New York rezone unless there is a community voice put behind it, and that voice should be the Coalition for Community Advancement. Thank you.
Any questions?
No.
The next speaker is Andrew Ortiz. Andrew Ortiz. Maria Julia Eckhart. Thank you for your patience, and
thank you.
I can actually say to you now, good evening.
Good evening, okay. And it's Eckhart. No,
Eckhart.
Eckhart.
Eckhart. Okay.
Like children.
Sorry.
Thank you. Good evening to the City Planning Commissioners. My name is Maria Julia Echart, and I'm a tenant organizer in Cypress Hills, and I'm a member of the Coalition for the Community Advancement. I will testify today on the importance of removing Arlington Village housing development from the East New York Rezone Plan. Arlington Village is in the heart of the rezone area, including Foursquare, city blocks, and well over 300,000 square feet for development. It has the potential to house hundreds of low-income residential units and multiple much-needed and difficult-to-develop community facilities, such as schools, community centers, and gardens, and fresh food supermarkets, too. We are not opposed to development per se. We ask only for the development that comes to be designed to meet the needs of the East New York community for deeply affordable housing and services. Arlington Village encompasses 212 units of low-income housing built in the 1940s. Today is the home to about 40 families, most of which have lived there for 30 to 40 and more years. The poor condition of the buildings and the warehousing of vacant units on the site have long been a blight both of the community and at large and Arlington Village residents themselves. Over decades, multiple elected officials and nonprofit developers have tried to purchase the site for affordable housing and community facility development. This parcel of land from Atlantic to Liberty Avenues was bought for $30 million earlier in 2015 by the Bluestone Group, a group that has made at least $1.6 billion in acquisitions in the past 2 years, and the city has said it has been trying to sell the parcel for $60 million already. The rezoning should not offer the owner the ability to make a windfall profit in exchange for market rate housing. Arlington Village is such a pivotal parcel in our community that it merits its own standalone public reviews process where the residents of East New York, Community Board 5, and the City Planning Commission can fully vet the owner's plan. In the draft environment impact statement, the city fails to acknowledge the rezone threat to residential displacement, direct and indirect. If Bluestone is allowed, it's only a little more to finish, just like this, just like this. If Bluestone is allowed to develop hundreds of market rate units in Arlington Village, not only with this would it displace current tenants who are currently paying roughly $800 for two-bedroom in rent-stabilized apartments and will not be able to find comparable housing anywhere but put intense pressure on nearby rents and property values. This owner is not required to set aside a large footprint for community facilities. Then the city will be able to claim that there aren't sufficient parcels in the neighborhoods to build more than one school for the neighborhood, even after it sees an increase of 25 to 50,000 residents. Already, Bluestone has harassed elderly Spanish-speaking tenants to move without any legally binding relocation agreements. They have made shoddy renovations resulting in already one electrical fire in a renovated unit. In a renovated unit in the FEIS, the city should consider an alternate rezone plan that excludes Arlington Village.
Thank you.
Such an exclusion,
Ms. Etcher. This. It's like this, not like that.
I swear, it's only this much.
You can do one more sentence. Could say finally.
That's going to be the wrap up then.
And you can, right? No, finally,
no,
and then hand it in.
In conclusion?
What?
In conclusion. In conclusion, the coalition urges the commission to vote no on the East New York plan unless Arlington Village is cut out of the rezone area and the other components of the alternate plan are implemented. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I think Tupper Thomas has left.
No.
What? Oh, okay, so she has submitted her testimony. The next five speakers are Brother Muhammad has spoken, Kate Slavin from the Municipal Arts Society, Zulmalinia Thane, Cheryl J., and Enrique Colon, who among you are here? Is Kate Slavin? No. Someone?
Come on down.
No. You spoke already. Who are you speaking for?
No.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. You did. Pardon me. I apologize.
Butchered out the name, the Zulmalinia Den.
I'm sorry?
Zulmalinia Den.
How do you do? I apologize.
No problem.
And this is numbers 106 to 110. So sorry. Okay.
Out of 1,000.
Go ahead.
All right. Okay, good afternoon, City Planning Commissioners. My name is Zulmalinia Den. I am founder of the of Preserving East New York, also known as PENNY. PENNY emerged as an initiative to advocate of the preservation of the historic buildings and places within the communities of East New York and Cypress Hills. Through community support, PENNY's goal is to create awareness to protect the community's historic resources that are threatened by the mayor's rezoning proposal. I want to commend to the city's holistic approach to this rezoning proposal by working with other city agencies such as DOT, Parks Department, SBS, to address the various strategic goals in the East New York rezoning proposal. But where is the Landmarks Preservation Commission in this conversation? The absence of the Landmarks Preservation Commission has caused great concern within the community. There are many unprotected and potentially vulnerable landmark-worthy buildings interspersed throughout the rezoning area. For example, the Community Center and PAL at 127 Pennsylvania Avenue is significant both architecturally and culturally. Did you know that this beautiful Greek temple used to be the neighborhood's courthouse? There's also the 75th Police Precinct Station House located at 44 Liberty Avenue. This Romanesque style fortress has been included into the National Register of Historic Places since 2007. These are just two of the buildings out of the 33 that Penny believes are landmark worthy that have not been addressed within this plan. As you know, New York City's preservation laws protect our history while also strengthening and empowering our communities. Preservation combined with sound planning and revitalization strategies drives economic growth and adds the community, and that which adds to the community's well-being. Therefore, preservation will promote growth opportunities for new and existing businesses and help create jobs while preserving and protecting existing structures, community organizations, small businesses, and local residents. So, Director Von Engel and fellow City Planning Commissioners, we urge you to consider preserving landmark-worthy buildings located within the rezoning area. Preservation may not fit perfectly into the goals of this plan, but these buildings are part of the heart which makes East New York, and Cypress Hills, Cypress Hills. City Planning Commissioners, if we can't revitalize our neighborhoods without protecting their history, character, and identity, without understanding these benefits, how can a neighborhood be effectively revitalized? City Planning Commissioners, you are the direct agency that will be responsible for the lasting transformation of this neighborhood and the other 14 neighborhoods that will follow in this plan's footsteps. So can you please make sure that the East New York Community Plan serves as an effective model to follow? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me just say that I'm sure I speak for all of my colleagues, that preservation of landmark quality buildings should be a part of any plan. And my understanding is that, thanks to your testimony at the borough president's hearing, you did submit a list of buildings that you think are worthy of protection that my understanding is the Landmarks Preservation Commission is now examining. So,
yes.
And of course, we are particularly mindful of their jurisdiction here and respectful of it as well. So I hope that they will take appropriate action, and I'm sure they will. So thank you very much, and thanks for bringing it to our attention.
Thank you.
Any questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Cheryl J. Enrique Colon.
I'm going to save the nice gender joke in the room. I'm obviously not Enrique Colon. I'm reading his statement on behalf of him, which I collected earlier this morning. So, good evening. My name is Enrique Colon, and I'm the outreach coordinator at CASA, Community Action for Safe Apartments. The housing organizing initiative of the new settlement apartments located in the Southwest Bronx. I am also a part of the Bronx Coalition for Community Vision. I have lived my entire life in the neighborhood being rezoned in the Bronx near Jerome Avenue. I'm here representing our coalition in the Bronx to let you know that we are watching and we are concerned. If housing is built and it isn't built for the people in the neighborhoods who need it the most, then who is it for? If getting some housing leads to the displacement of thousands of black, brown, and immigrant residents of our city, then in whose interest are we doing this? Your decisions about how to move forward in East New York will send a message not just to the residents here, but to thousands of us in the Bronx, who we care about as a city and whose lives we value the most. The average income for families in East New York is $33,000 per year. How does this plan ensure enough housing for them? How does it prevent displacement? How does it paint a path towards union jobs and local hire? How does it reflect the needs and priorities that community members have outlined for you in their own plan? We are concerned that our brothers and sisters in East New York are not happy with this plan. If they aren't happy, that means they haven't been respected. What you decide has implications and will set the stage for the rest of the city. We hope that when we meet again in the Bronx, we will know that you take us seriously and respect the gravity of our work to create a more just city. Respectfully, Enrique Colom.
Thank you very much. Questions? Thank you. So the next five speakers are numbers 116 through 120, and five are Kayla Rivera, who I believe spoke before.
No, I spoke for Jonathan Thurman. I was going to speak for Thomas Stone. It wasn't a Thurman. You all.
No, it doesn't work. You can only.
No, find someone else.
You can only speak once. Sorry.
That's
you can't be a utility player that speaks for five people. It just doesn't work that way. The next speaker is Navid Hussein. You can submit testimony for someone else. Okay. Navid Hussein. Roy Frias.
Yes, I'm Rebecca Crimmins. I'm a project manager at Cypress Hills Local Development Corporation. I'll be reading testimony on behalf of Roy Frias. It's my first time at the mic. Good afternoon, evening.
First and only appearance of the night.
That's right.
Excellent. Okay.
Good afternoon, planning commissioners. My name is Roy Frias. I'm a member of East New York Farms, a program of United Community Centers, and we are a member of the Coalition for Community Advancement. I stand before you today as a concerned citizen and community resident. The reason our community has not stood behind this rezoning plan is because this plan is not the right way to invest in our neighborhood. Throughout the years, we have seen gentrification in Williamsburg, Bushwick, Bed-Stuy, and Harlem, covered up by urban renewal projects. These same neighborhoods have seen tremendous losses in affordable housing because the rent is already too high. At its very core, gentrification is about working families not being able to afford to live and raise families anymore. We lived and stayed in these places despite our struggles because we believe that this was the right place to be, and we continue to invest our lives in this quote-unquote study area. We may not be able to invest the millions of dollars developers use to make more millions from our community, but we speak from a place of understanding that the rent this plan is calling for will bring gentrification to our neighborhood. Real estate prices have increased dramatically in neighborhoods like Bed-Stuy, Park Slope, and Fort Greene in only a few years. As the cost of living has risen, incomes have not. While many landlords continue to find ways to increase revenue, New Yorkers are being pushed out of their homes. Over the years, the affordable housing stock continues to be depleted as rent-stabilized units are taken off the market. While one goal of rezoning parts of East New York and other New York City neighborhoods is to develop additional affordable housing, we need to prioritize maintaining and preserving the existing affordable housing that exists. We want to ensure first and foremost that the people who live in this community now can stay in their homes as we welcome with open arms a new community of quote-unquote housing refugees. In East New York, half of all households earn less than $30,000 a year. We want 100% of what the city builds here in our neighborhood to be built for the people who live here. Historically, East New York saw redlining deny mortgages. We're a neighborhood that is already under attack, and we want a plan that supports us more. Give us rents that will allow the community to stay, that families making $34,000 a year can afford. We demand that the city help create living wage jobs for our community. We demand that the city work with our community to create programs for skills that will build self-sustainable people. We demand a training and workforce development center, support for small businesses, and preservation of manufacturing jobs with living wages and jobs with a future. The Community Board 5 in East New York has voted no. The borough president has voted no on the rezone. Now it's up to you. I thank the city for all the work they have done, and I hope this conversation ends with community interests at heart. vote no unless it's the coalition's alternate plan.
Thank you very much.
Thank
Questions?
You. Thank you.
Next speaker is Sabine Aronofsky. Sabine Aronofsky. Next speaker is Rosalind McIntosh. Rosalind McIntosh, Community Board 5. Okay. Next speaker, next five speakers, numbers 126 to 130 are Rebecca Crimmins, Adam Myers, Rama Gowden, Jorge Gomez, and Anna Aguirre. And you are?
I'm Adam Myers.
Is Rebecca Crimmins here?
I read
this. You gave up your spot for somebody else. That's very generous. Okay, thank you. Thank you.
That's what we're here for. Good afternoon, Chairman and Commissioners. My name is Adam Myers. I'm a housing lawyer working with Brooklyn Legal Services Corporation A. It's a community-based legal services office which has been serving for 40 years the neighborhoods in North and East Brooklyn. I've come to oppose the rezoning proposal in its current form and to support the comments and the community plan offered by the Coalition for Community Advancement. Mayor de Blasio and his administration have emphasized that this housing plan aims to build and preserve affordable housing in order to foster a more equitable and livable New York City. These goals are the right goals, but as with so many things, the devil is in the details. My office has approached the proposed rezoning with a concern that was born in our extensive experience working with the neighborhoods of Williamsburg and Greenpoint in the decade following the waterfront rezoning there. That rezoning action, too, promised an expansion of affordable housing. However, while the promises of affordability have failed to materialize, rampant speculation and luxury development arrived in full force. Skyrocketing property values have led to a massive increase in the harassment and displacement of long-term low-income residents, and rather than satisfying the city's demand for luxury housing, each new development seems to accelerate the rate at which rent-regulated units are demolished and market-rate high-rises come in. As noble as its stated aims may be, the proposed rezoning will not actually improve housing affordability without substantial improvement to the quantity of affordable units and the depth of affordability demanded of developers, and the ongoing vigilance of government actors in enforcing our housing laws. The scope of these needs has been described compellingly by many others who have spoken this afternoon and evening, and is addressed extensively in the coalition's written comments. One issue that has thus far gone completely unaddressed in the city's proposal is the need to ensure that the rezoning action will preserve and expand the fairness of housing in East New York and Cypress Hills. In its written comments, the coalition has urged the city to consider fair housing impacts in its analysis. The city has thus far flatly refused to do so. The fact is that an analysis of the potential perpetuation of residential segregation under a proposed rezoning falls squarely within the proper scope of the city's obligations. Under Chapter 5 of the city's Seeker Technical Manual, the city must analyze the indirect residential displacement that may accompany a proposed rezoning and determine whether the proposed project may either introduce a trend or accelerate a trend of changing socioeconomic conditions that may potentially displace a vulnerable population. A full analysis of whether a rezoning is likely to result in discrimination against people of particular protected classes is clearly required by city regulations. An analysis of the fair housing implications of the proposed action is also required under federal law. As a recipient of federal housing funds, under HUD regulations, the city's strategies and actions must affirmatively further fair housing. To affirmatively further fair housing is defined as taking meaningful actions in addition to combating discrimination that overcome patterns of segregation and foster inclusive communities free from barriers that restrict access to opportunity based on protected characteristics. In conclusion,
that's a lawyer for you. Thank you so much. You're very disciplined, and I, on behalf of my former profession, I admire that.
Perfect. The city has insisted that the proposed action is rooted in a desire to ensure that the neighborhood continues to serve diverse housing needs and to protect neighborhood character. I joined the coalition in urging the city to consider the historic and existing patterns of residential segregation in the communities affected by the proposed action, and to incorporate into its plan mitigations ensuring that residents' fair housing rights will be protected. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Myers. Questions, Mr. Myers, Mrs. Ortiz, Ms. Della Oos, I may have a question too.
Hi, quick question. Having recently been appointed, I was not involved with the Greenpoint rezoning, and you referenced that. What for you is the difference? There was no mandatory, I presume, in that rezoning, and here there would be. So is that a significant difference?
I would say it's certainly significant, but I think it's probably fair to say that everyone has been surprised by what the actual extent of the, for lack of a better word, gentrification in Williamsburg and Greenpoint has been over the last decade. There were certain mitigations put into place at the time of the waterfront rezoning, including funding for legal services activity there, and we were talking earlier about certificates of no harassment, a sort of limited anti-harassment zone along the waterfront. But those measures, in my opinion, I think in the opinion of most people, have not adequately protected the local residents from displacement. A lot of people have been displaced. It's a lot of tenant harassment, even still 10 years later.
So certainly the issue of displacement, but the new construction, had there been a mandatory component, would have included a set-aside that we don't see now.
I'm sorry, I don't fully understand the question.
The new development in Greenpoint,
yes.
Had there been an MIH,
sure.
Layered on top, we would have seen affordable housing.
That's true. We would have seen more affordable housing than we have in this case, mm-hmm. But I guess I would assert not nearly enough to compensate the community for the sort of indirect displacement that has occurred with the continuing skyrocketing of the residential prices and the illegal evictions and the renovations of the units taking place in regulation, et cetera.
Certainly, though, there are very significant differences between Greenpoint, its location, its proximity to sort of the...
Absolutely. We had Commissioner Mastrullo in here a few minutes ago. He said that there was not much of the same sort of harassment that we've seen in neighborhoods like Williamsburg and Greenpoint in the proposed rezone area. I think I would disagree with him based on just anecdotally what I've seen. As long ago as 2013, I was seeing at least one big example of tenants being illegally evicted so that the landlord could gut renovate a big building and turn it into what appeared to be pretty luxurious market rate units. We're not seeing anything like what we've got in Williamsburg and Greenpoint in the rezone area now, but I think that could be coming.
Thank you.
Ms. Delos, then Ms. Levin.
Thank you for your testimony and for raising the issue of fair housing. I'm just wondering, besides asking the city to do further analysis specific to fair housing, have you all begun your own analysis and come to any conclusions?
So my office in particular, we don't really have so much of a policy apparatus. We haven't done much of the analysis ourselves. I think right now the ask is that the analysis be done and that the city respond reasonably to whatever it discovers.
Thank you.
Ms. Levin.
Yeah, Mr. Myers, do you have any experience working with the certificate of no harassment process? Have you tried to get a certificate from HPD?
So I'm on the other side. I work for the tenants that fight against the issuance of the certificate.
Well, correct. So I should put it another way. Have you been involved in advocating for tenants in situations where you know harassment has occurred and you've tried to make that case to HPD?
In one instance, I have.
And yes. How did that work out?
I was glad that the process was there because there was clearly a serious investigation done. I would say that HPD made the wrong decision in my case, but I know other people that think that it's a very important tool in the toolkit of protecting tenants from harassment in these developing areas.
Okay, do you have any idea whether cases of harassment have been found in Greenpoint, Williamsburg? I know in the special Clinton district, yeah, I think I can count three of them. Although one guy went to jail, so that one counts for extra.
Right, we've got a couple that have been indicted, but I don't have any personal experience with an actual court finding of harassment. Certainly there have been settlements, there have been allegations, there have been, okay. Et cetera, but
of course, that's not the point, actually, is to be a disincentive. But.
Right, right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I have a couple questions. One, you said you thought there were instances of harassment in East New York, although not that many at the moment. Have were those instances that you were personally aware of, and did you speak to HPD about them?
Sure. I continue to work with a tenant association at a building at the intersection of Legion and Pitkin in Brownsville. I don't have the map perfectly in my head. I don't know whether that's in the area or just very close to it. But these tenants were displaced from their home by a vacate order after a fire. They obviously had the right to return under city law. The landlord refused to let them return. And when eventually they got back into the apartment without the landlord's permission, they found that these units had been extensively renovated into very much luxury, high-quality apartments that were better than a lot of what I've seen in Williamsburg and Greenpoint. That's just one data point. I can't speak so well to the larger trends, but it has happened. Yeah.
Also, this whole issue of fair housing, which is, as you probably know a lot better than I, is a very complex and tricky legal terrain at the moment. Totally understand your concerns about displacement, but also looking at it from the segregation perspective, and particularly the economic segregation perspective, doesn't that militate in a neighborhood like East New York, a policy goal of having a mix of incomes, that middle income as well as lower income, just as in wealthier neighborhoods, the goal is to introduce a lower income population precisely because of the concerns about income segregation?
I think that's definitely a point of view that has been advanced by a lot of people, and I think that's one of the big factors that's been involved with this case, that's questioning whether you can do these local preferences in affordable housing in these rezoned areas. My office's position, and maybe this is not surprising for a legal services office, is everything that we're doing with fair housing laws is trying to protect those that are otherwise disadvantaged economically or
and appropriately
whatever.
So, and I certainly totally understand.
But no, I think you're right that one can make a reasonable argument that there is some sense in which the concerns of fair housing and the end of segregation and whatnot are met by having a diverse neighborhood, both in terms of race and in terms of nationality and in terms of income and all of these factors. Yes.
No, I was just thinking about it from both a fair housing perspective and a policy perspective, but I don't know how much of the testimony you heard about earlier about particularly retail demand and the importance of having, not only for all kinds of social reasons that we've seen in recently about how children do better if they're living in mixed income neighborhoods, poor children do better if they're living in mixed income neighborhoods, but also a lot of the testimony here about retail demand and about the neighborhood's both desire for more and better retail, but also the need to have purchasing power that could sustain that retail.
Right. I don't think that anyone, I probably can't speak for the coalition beyond what I've done already.
I'm just asking more.
I don't understand the community as saying we don't want wealthier people coming in, we don't want a diversity of businesses coming in, we don't want these things. I think the concern is we're happy to have these things and we're comfortable with an increased density, but we've just really got to make sure that we preserve what is already here. We don't want to improve the neighborhood.
Understood. I mean, I don't mean to suggest otherwise that, I mean, clearly there's a great concern about displacement.
I think you're right to note that there can be benefits to a community when new things come in, whether they're immigrant population moving in or whether they are wealthier people coming in that bring with them money that that supports businesses and things like that.
I mean, that's and understanding the dynamic here is what makes the both the fair housing issues difficult and the displacement issues difficult and the regulatory issues difficult.
Yeah, the fair housing issues can be extremely difficult. I just think the very first step is do the analysis. I mean, there have been cases in the past where the city has not done an analysis, and that's probably a big part of why, at least in Williamsburg, the Broadway Triangle rezoned area is still tied up with a preliminary injunction against development on the city site 6 years later.
It's a whole other matter. So.
Yeah.
Ms. Dulles?
Now, you pretty much covered it. I think the primary point I think you're trying to make with the fair housing request for the fair housing analysis is more on the displacement side and whether or not there's a disparate impact specific to race and income on the potential displacement side.
To be sure, that would be what I'd be most concerned about. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Myers. Next speaker is Ramon Gowden. You testified already, Mr. Gowden. That's it. Once. No.
You did it.
We've enforced that rule. Nope. Nobody spoke twice. Absolutely nobody spoke twice. Nope. Jorge Gomez. Anna Aguirre? Aguirre?
I'm speaking for her.
Okay.
My name is Gemma Garcia. I'm a resident of East New York. Good afternoon, City Planning Commission. I'm speaking for Anna Aguirre, the Executive Director of United Community Centers in East New York. We are proud members of the Coalition for Community Advancement. I am testifying on the need for the city to plan more emergency services as part of the East New York plan. We are urging you to vote no on the city's East New York plan unless it is the coalition's alternative plan. The city acknowledges the rezone will bring about 24,455 residents and workers to the area. But it says that the rezone will not create a sizable new neighborhood where none existed before. And so there is no need to assess the potential impact to fire protection. It seems impossible given the density and built-up nature of Brooklyn and the population increase that our neighborhood wouldn't need additional fire protection services. The coalition continues to request that the final environmental impact statement include an assessment of the potential impacts to fire protection. In addition, since both Engine 236 and Engine 332, Ladder 175, are located directly next to the proposed development sites within the rezoning area, the coalition asks that the draft environmental impact statement assess how developing these sites would potentially impact or inhibit access to these facilities. The coalition is pleased that these concerns were heard. However, the DEIS concluded that no construction impacts would be expected and that response times would, and I quote, not be materially affected by construction due to the geographic distribution of the police and fire facilities and their respective coverage areas. We believe there would be a serious impact that would threaten the safety of all of us. Like with fire protection, the coalition asks that the draft environmental impact statement assess what additional NYPD patrols, personnel, and facilities will be needed to serve the estimated 24,455 new residents and workers. The request was also based in the fact that the 75th Police Precinct is one of the geographically largest in the city. The city's response was the same as its response to the request to study indirect impact on fire protection. The rezoning, and I quote, will not create a sizable new neighborhood where none existed before, and is therefore is not needed. Again, similarly to fire protection, the coalition strongly believes that the size of the rezone and the population increase merits assessment in the final environmental impact assessment. May I finish? I just have two paragraphs. I'll go fast.
One paragraph.
No. Okay. Including sentences.
All right. This plan must be more than a housing plan. It must address the needs of existing community members, especially our needs for emergency services. Because the city's plan failed to identify our neighborhood's increasing needs for emergency services and mitigate threats to public safety, we urge the City Planning Commission to vote no to the East New York rezoning plan and advocate for the adoption of the alternative plan presented by the Coalition for Community Advancement. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Questions? Next speaker is Deputy Commissioner Daniel Hernandez from HPD. Penultimate. Almost. Getting there.
Thank you for your patience and your voices this morning and this afternoon, this evening now. It's clearly provided an opportunity for the community's voices to be heard, which is why I remained here all day and listened. And as you can see, there's a complex web of issues that the housing plan has to consider and that we will continue to consider. Clearly, some of the concerns we heard today are ones that we have heard previously. And we heard newly formed ideas on how we might refine our analysis to meet community objectives that we heard today. Mostly, I want to reiterate that we are working tirelessly to address the affordability concerns we heard to ensure that the city resources are maximized and targeted to meet the needs of the East New York community, particularly the low and extremely low income neighbors and community members that we heard from today. Pressures due to population growth and a restricted housing supply will continue to put pressures on housing costs, particularly, as we heard today, for families living in East New York. Our objective is to stabilize housing costs of families living in East New York, as well as to ensure the availability of permanently affordable housing into the future. We're doing that in three broad ways, as I spoke earlier this week. One is the development of new affordable housing, either that we finance at HPD. It will be 100% affordable, and we will use the extremely low and low-income housing term sheet to address the needs of those families living in East New York, and through the Mandatory Inclusionary Housing Program, which will be an ongoing program that will guarantee that the community will have permanently affordable housing built in their neighborhood, an unprecedented strategy for HPD and the city and the planning department. We will continue to expand our preservation programs. We heard today that people didn't necessarily hear enough about our preservation work. We are, and as I said earlier on Monday, we're expanding the small home program so that we're making those home loans more available to new homeowners as well as existing homeowners that want to do improvements on their homes as a choice that they can make rather than sell their house, they can stay in the neighborhood. We're also looking at the buildings that are regulated that we can work with the landlords to ensure that we provide preservation financing so those existing affordable units, regulated units, stay in the neighborhood's pipeline so that those families continue to live in affordable units. And finally, the work that we're doing in collaboration with other city agencies, legal services, the tenant protection unit, and others, to make sure that our resources are leveraged by their resources so that anti-harassment and anti-displacement strategies are put into place, and to the extent that we can provide housing resources to problem areas that we see through harassment, that we're able to deploy those resources effectively. So again, we'll continue to refine our housing plan based on what we heard today. It's a draft plan, but it really was helpful, and I thank everybody who's here this evening still for all the great input that we heard today, and we were all taking notes, and we'll continue to use those. So thank you very much, commissioners and members of the community, for all your hard work.
Thank you very much, Commissioner. Questions for Commissioner Hernandez? Ms. Delavos.
Daniel, thank you very, very much for being here all day as
yes.
well. Because we heard so much about harassment, and because Commissioner Bean spoke earlier, and you did as well during the review session, about the intention of trying to achieve the intention of what an anti-harassment special district could achieve without actually having an anti-harassment special district. 3,000 units is a lot of units yep. that it could potentially apply to. I'm just wondering, and perhaps it's too soon for you to say whether or not the conversation today has led to a rethinking of that, but that's a pretty sizable number of units. It's almost the number of units that HPD is trying to create with the 3,500 units. And you know, if HPD is going to stay on this method of argument, that this percentage is too low to justify that, then the question then becomes, what is the percentage that would trigger it? So you can imagine that that's going to be some of my follow-up questions later.
Yes, I can imagine that. And as you can imagine, all of you can imagine, I was, you know, ciphering through emails this afternoon as well. So the conversations are going fast within HPD. We're talking to Vito's group, the legal department that actually reviews all the certificate of harassment, to see where the how the program's been performing, what success rates it has, how cures have actually been implemented, and how we might be able to tighten up the program, and whether it becomes zoning or some other regulatory strategy we can deploy. There's clear conversation, so we will. The momentum based on these conversations has been built within inside HPD, and we want to open it up to others who are working legal services, particularly who are working on these issues on the ground.
And if I may, I appreciate all of that, and I think it's an important part of the conversation that we should absolutely have. I think in some ways, the biggest benefit of what it does is the message that it sends to the market about what the behavior is that will be tolerated and not tolerated. And in some ways, you can't measure things that don't happen because people choose not to do something because something exists. And I just want to put that out there because that's a very big piece.
Yes, and continue to iterate that. That's very, very good.
Ms. Ortiz.
Hi. I'm really glad to hear about the anti-displacement piece. I think that's really, you know, the critical to ensure that we're creating mixed-income neighborhoods, which we know are important to outcomes, ultimately people's personal outcomes. But my question has to do, and this is more global, like stepping back. We've heard a lot from, you know, opponents that the affordability is not deep enough. Mm-hmm. We know that HPD is committing to deeper levels of affordability that will happen in a sort of non-regulatory, as part of the non-regulatory piece of this. Having looked at, I'm sure, other similar inclusionary programs around the country, mm-hmm. as you sort of, in your work, you know, are we the most aggressive here? You know, I mean, are advocates asking for something that has never been done before? And should we be, you know, where do we fit on this spectrum of the levels of affordability? Should we be pleased with where we are? Or, you know, or is there something out there, you know, that potentially is a best practice that we can learn from to deepen those levels of affordability?
There was a study done with DCP and HPD on comparing our proposal or proposed MIH program to other cities, and we are going deeper as compared to other cities. It's much broader and much deeper. And the other thing that I think is extreme, I was in San Francisco when we were working on the MIH program there, and it was a citywide program, so there wasn't the opportunity that we have today to actually engage people in that. The importance of going deep or going high and going in the middle. We heard today about families that aren't being addressed through a lot of the financial resources that we have available, meaning that moderate income, working family, and how what resources do we have available to keep those families living in neighborhoods. So the program is designed to actually be as feasible as possible so that it works within the marketplace on its own, so that we're able then to dedicate our resources to going lower when neighborhoods and communities want that in their housing stock. So for example, in East New York, again, as I was saying earlier in the week, that we're then able to work on these early projects on in the MIH, under the MIH program, it sets the baseline. So on that baseline, then we're actually able to go deeper on projects that HPD will be subsidizing. So it's just setting the baseline for the requirements so that, again, as I was saying earlier, it will live on and there will always be the development of affordable housing whenever any residential development is occurring within the MIH zones.
Thank you.
Sure.
Any other questions for Mr. Hernandez? So thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you for your patience today and listening through all of this, and patience of your colleagues as well.
Yes, you're
thank
welcome.
You. The last speaker that I have a card for is HRA Commissioner Stephen Banks. And Mr. Banks, I believe you may have the last word. Welcome.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your indulgence. I know you've been listening to lots of testimony. I have some testimony to give, but I want to assure you that I'm going to summarize it very briefly. I see some of my familiar friends here, and I know that you're smiling when I'm saying that. First, as you know, the Human Resources Administration provides assistance to about 3 million New Yorkers through a whole range of programs aimed at helping fight poverty and income inequality. Among the programs that we have implemented are programs that have a direct bearing in terms of providing stabilization services in the neighborhoods that are subject to what you're considering tonight and earlier today. Some of you know I used to run the Legal Aid Society, and I spent many years representing tenants in court before I became the head of the organization. I did represent some at that time, too. And one of the forces that I've seen over the years, and I know the chair's heard me say this before, but when I first started to work at the Legal Aid Society, our Chelsea office was the largest office that we had because of the numbers of low-income people between 34th Street and the Battery west of Broadway. And in those days, we wished that we could have had a program to provide representation to anyone who was subject to harassment. If we had such a program, that neighborhood would look quite different. And that's why it's so important, I think, that you consider the program that the mayor has funded, the HRA is managing, for legal services to be provided in neighborhoods where there's rezoning. And the commitment is to provide representation to tenants who are the victims of harassment. And in addition to that, we have other programs that help tenants who are at risk of non-payment, eviction, or poor conditions leading towards the need for code enforcement work. And the amount of money that we're spending on this is important to consider when you consider what does it really mean for our services to be important or a critical piece of stabilization in neighborhoods. In 2013, the amount of money that was available for legal services of this sort was just over $6 million. That's increasing tenfold. So the amount of legal services that are available starting in FY17 will be more than $60 million. It's unprecedented. There's no program like it in the country. And it's really a commitment of the administration to provide services to people so they can remain in neighborhoods and that they can be able to have stability in their lives. And that if there are conditions of disrepair, and if there is other factors that sometimes arise in the housing market with respect to development issues, that tenants can remain in place whenever possible, and that victims of harassment will be defended. And in certain respects, this has created a virtual right to counsel in certain neighborhoods of the city. And the neighborhood that you're looking at here is one such neighborhood. We already have great experience with the Legal Aid Society and Legal Services NYC, and there'll be other providers as well providing these kind of stabilization services. Our testimony talks about other services that HRA has provided, including services in night shift developments and job training programs and employment services that we provide, all of which we think are very important to neighborhood stability. But I think the most important service that we provide is this new service that the mayor is supporting, and I just wanted to come here and highlight it. I realize if you're waiting for me to have like some dramatic new testimony from HRA, you're going to be disappointed. But I think it's such an important program, I wanted to come here and personally deliver that message to you.
I do have a, thank you very much, and I do have a question for you.
Sure.
And perhaps my colleagues will as well, and especially given your experience as a litigator and as manager of the Legal Aid Society and chief counsel there. There's been a, and your experience in Chelsea, because there's been some testimony that regarding an anti-harassment provision in the zoning in Chelsea, and one of our commissioners, I think Commissioner Levin, said that she was aware of three cases where that provision came into play. I don't think there's, we haven't
heard. Where harassment was found.
Where harassment was found. And we've heard of, so far, there may be some, but we've heard of no provisions where harassment was found in Williamsburg. There may be, but we haven't heard of any, through that zoning provision. But it always seemed to me that the most effective means of addressing harassment was to have a good lawyer and a good advocate. And I just wonder, based on your experience and your experience managing lawyers defending tenants, as well as your management of the program that you've now implemented, a very robust program, whether that is, in fact, given your experience, the most effective way to address harassment. We're not talking about displacement, which is a whole other issue, but harassment.
I think legal. That's right. And you know, I gave the example of Chelsea, but look, I live in Windsor Terrace, and when I first began representing clients, the actual clients I represented lived in Park Slope. At that time, at the legal aid study, we had a handful of lawyers providing representation at Park Slope, probably less than 10. And the amount of funding and expansion of legal services for this program is exponentially beyond that. I think that what I have seen in my own representation and what led us to develop this program is that there's two kinds of situations that develop for tenants. And they're outside of the purview of most of New York and outside of the purview of most cities, most residents in most cities where this goes on. There are cases that are brought, and it's a David against Goliath situation in housing court, because you've got an unrepresented tenant against the represented landlord. And the other situation are the cases that never get brought, because people don't have the information, people don't know where to go, they're afraid, and they leave because they think they have no alternative. And so providing legal services is a good disinfectant, if you will, for those two kinds of problems. And in terms of homelessness, I remember meeting with many administrations. I know when the mayor appointed me, it was said that I had sued 6 governors and 4 mayors, not this one. And always saying, if you really wanted to prevent homelessness, keeping people in their homes and making sure the conditions were habitable was such an important ingredient of doing so. And I have to say that all those years, if someone told me that you'd have a mayor that would increase tenfold the amount of legal services funding that would be available and targeted for just these kind of cases, I would say, well, that would be great. I'm going to aim for that. But here we are. Here we are. And I think the kinds of services, as you point out, are such an important piece of leveling the playing field for tenants and giving them the ability to address very real problems that are too often unseen, but the lawyers can ferret out the problems. These are reputable organizations. They work with community-based organizations on the ground. There are city staff as well making referrals. People come into HRA offices. We have HRA staff in the courthouses. So there are numbers of different places where help can be provided in a much more robust way than in any time in the experience that I've had in the city.
Thank you. I would just say that if legal services funding had been expanded 10 times when I was a legal services lawyer, I would still be a legal services lawyer. alas, that was not the case when I was a legal services lawyer. But I really do know from my own experience litigating on behalf of tenants how essentially essential it is to have a lawyer who's fighting for you.
Right, and I should just add, and I don't want to belabor the point, but I should add that, and the tools that we're funding are not just case-by-case representation. The ability to represent a building can preserve affordable housing units, not just for the tenants that happen to come in, but the whole building. And that's an important service and tool that in the past frequently was not funded. Frequently was only case by case.
Right.
And we are giving, these are, again, longstanding organizations, and we're giving them the expert judgment that they make about a harassment case and when building representation is appropriate and when individual representation is appropriate. And I think we're seeing really very good results already.
Thank you so much. Questions? Commissioner Levin, then Commissioner Efron, then Commissioner Delavis.
Well, I'm going to hold back on. I was going to ask about, I mean, my biggest worry in what we're doing here is that if we don't succeed in the tenant preservation side, we're really adding clients to the city's homeless population, and that's a pretty scary place to be. But it's late in the evening for talking about, I mean, the point is made and it's out there, and I think we understand that's the risk that we're facing here. I just want to clarify to the chair's point about my knowledge of the special Clinton district has gotten a little bit stale. The fact that there were so few actually documented cases of harassment, we always felt in the community, was proof of the effectiveness of the deterrent, because the penalty for harassing your tenants was that any new development was going to have to produce permanent affordable housing. And that requirement continued to anyone you sold the property to. So the idea was that it was such a huge penalty that it would deter harassment. So the fact that there are so few cases may, in fact, prove that it works.
I'll sort of leave that for the panel to analyze. I just would say in my experience over the years, you have to know you've got the ability to make such a claim, and you've got to have someone available to help you make such a claim. And that's, I think, the big difference in the approach that we're taking now. We're giving the availability of someone to let you know you have the claim, and then someone to enable you to bring the claim under existing law.
That's right.
Because poor conditions, repeated attempts to evict somebody when they have paid the rent, overcharges, claiming units are not in rent stabilization when they really are. These are all things that on the ground legal services can use existing tools to protect.
Right, and you need local organizations that maintain the long history over time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Ms. Efron.
It strikes me that between this and the anti-harassment work of the HPD, and these are larger efforts now that probably yield some really important data for both the Department of City Planning and us as a commission. Mm-hmm. So if there is some way to actually add to the transparency of successful representation as well as claims on the HPD side, I think it would be really useful, because in a way you will be spotting trends before the department makes determinations.
I think that's a very good point. We are working very closely with HPD. And I think we're very concerned about making sure that we're doing exactly what you're suggesting, which is let's document what we're actually doing. On a parallel track, by the way, we're going to be doing a study of what's the remaining unmet need in housing court. The only available study is one from 1993 that I had some familiarity with. It was done by the Community Training Resource Center and something called the Citywide Task Force on Housing Court. And I was a board member of the Community Training Resource Center. And we want to know, when you take into account the legal services funding from the mayor through HRA and the dramatic increase in funding from the chief judge through OCA, what is actually the remaining residual need? There certainly is a remaining need, but we want to understand what it is. And part of what you're asking us to do in terms of documenting trends is right in line with that activity.
Ms. Delavis.
Commissioner Banks, first, I just want to thank you for coming and sharing that information. And I've been a longtime admirer of all of your work. Obviously, we have the right to shelter to thank you. Thank you for that. You know, notwithstanding all of the admiration I have, and especially for the commitment that the administration has made towards legal services, the analogy that I think about when I think about the issues that we're talking about here is, an anti-harassment special district that's codified in zoning is like an inoculation. The legal services is like providing medicine. When if we don't do any of these things, everybody's going to end up in the emergency room. And I just think that it's just too important to try to provide all tools so that we don't have folks in the shelters or in the emergency room.
Well, I mean, I would certainly say in my world, I've lived in the emergency room I've been in a few emergency rooms with you over the years, and certainly your colleagues as well. Having lived in the emergency room, however, the medicine is really, really important.
No question.
And
no question.
Some diseases are best addressed with medicine. Some diseases are best addressed other ways. Well, we like to look at legal services as the ultimate in prevention. For years, I remember testifying in hearings like this, always saying, you know, for every dollar invested, you save dollars in shelter, and an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. It's a rare chance in your professional life that you actually get to do something about that. So I'm grateful for the resources. I appreciate your kind words. But I do think that it's important to see this program as a very different governmental response to development. Which, just to be blunt about it, has been happening without the kind of approach that's being taken here. Look at Crown Heights, for example, where development happened without any government intervention at all and without the legal services. So the legal services are really important, and the resolution you have before you, I think, is really important, and that would be a big change for some of the communities that we see people coming from who are in the shelter system. So the kinds of protections that we are providing, plus the addition of initiatives to increase the housing supply, are so critically important. And I say that not just because recently now I'm running two agencies, one of which is the homeless agency, but because it's really a concern, I think, for all New Yorkers to address the supply of affordability at many different levels so that there are simply more options for people in the city, which ultimately going to help the clients of HRA, which are my direct charge these days.
Any other questions for Commissioner Banks? Hearing none. Thank you very much for testifying.
Right, well. I wish you all luck.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to be heard on this matter? Seeing none, hearing none, the hearing is now officially closed. I want to say that the record will remain open for 10 days until Tuesday, January 19th, to accept written comments on the draft environmental impact statement, and the record of more generally is open as well until any written testimony we welcome. So thank you very much. Madam Secretary, is there any other matters to come before us today? No?
No.
I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
We are adjourned.